Hello, Sukshita, we are live now. You can start.
Yes. Good evening, everyone. I'm Sukshita. And on behalf of 4Optum team, I would like to welcome you all. Today, we have Ms. Shravani Raj with us. Ms. Shravani is currently studying second year BSc Optometry in Netradhama School of Optometry, Bangalore. Today, she'll be discussing on Humphrey Field Analyzer. As the session is live in YouTube, I request all the viewers to drop any queries about the presentation in the comment box. We'll be discussing all the queries at the end of the session. Shravani, you can take over the session now.
Thank you, Sukshita, for the introduction. Good evening, everyone. Myself, Shravani. Today, I'm going to present on the topic HFA, that is Humphrey Field Analyzer. So what is HFA? It is a tool for measuring human visual field. It is done monocularly, and the results are stored and used for monitoring the progression of vision loss and the patient's condition. So the main aim of visual field analyzer is to measure the retinal sensitivity. So before going to the procedure, we need to know some terminologies. So here it is threshold, the weakest test stimulus just visible, which varies across the visual field. So in layman language, we can say if the light is thrown 100 times, it appreciated 50 times is known as threshold. So if it is seen 90%, it is supra threshold. If it is in 15%, it is infra threshold. Then we have decibels and apostille. Decibels are also known as relative unit, which is in the value in HFA. And apostille is known as absolute unit, which is fixed. It will not vary from instrument to instrument. So 0 dB is the brightest light, which is equals to 10,000 absolute unit. And 0 dB is inversely proportional to absolute unit. Then we have isopter. It is the line connecting all points which has equal threshold. So it connects the points which are having same or equal threshold. Then we have scotoma, physiological scotoma, blind spot everyone has due to the optic nerve head, where there are no photoreceptors like rods and cones. Then we have positive scotoma, a blind spot the patient is aware of. They can sense it, usually due to retinal injury. Then we have negative scotoma, a blind spot the patient is unaware of, usually due to damage of visual pathway. Then we have absolute scotoma. No target can be seen in a particular location, regardless of how bright you make it. So here it will be complete darkness. Then we have relative scotoma, an area of the visual field in which perception of light is only diminished, not totally. Then we have other types of scotoma like Dreyram scotoma, also known as Orchid scotoma, which is an arc shape. Then we have paracentral scotoma, which is near to the center, but not exact at the center. Then we have blind spot, which is the physiological one. Then we have sidereal scotoma, which is sickle in shape. Then we have centrosical scotoma, which lies between the central scotoma and blind spot. Then we have central scotoma, which is exact at the center. Then we have nasal step, which lies at the nasal periphery. Then we have ill of vision. So at the peak, it is known as foveal vision or foveal region, where there will be highest vision at the fovea and it decreases peripherally. Then we have maximum extent of visual field in one eye. Superiorly, it is 60 degree. Inferiorly, it is 75 degree. Temporally, it is 100 degree. And nasally, it is 60 degree. Humphrey visual field test. The visual field test of Humphrey field analyzer are broadly divided into two types depending on the testing strategies used during the test. They are threshold test and screening test. Depending on point pattern, the threshold test are divided into three types. They are central test, peripheral test, specialty test. In central test, we have central 30-2, central 24-2, central 10-2, and macular program. In peripheral test, we have peripheral 60-4, nasal step, temporal crescent. And in specialty test, we have neurological 20 and neurological 30. Now I'm going to discuss mainly about central test because it is the mostly used for testing. And we have central 30-2. So what is this 30-2? From center to the 30 degree of visual field area is known as 30. And 2 is the x-axis and y-axis, or horizontal or vertical meridian. And there are total 76 points. Distance between each 2 points is 6 degree. It is used to test central area. Then we have central 24-2, which is default one. We check 24 degree of visual field area. Total 54 points. Distance between each point is 6 degree. Here we can see at the nasal area, there are two extra dots. So here there are two extra dots. So it indicates the for detection of early glaucoma. Then we have central 10-2, total 68 points. Distance between each point is 2 degree. So if there is any specified central scotomas, we can make it out. Then we have macular program from center to 5 degrees of visual field area, total 16 points. Distance between each point is 2 degrees. It is used to test the macular region. Then coming to the testing strategies, we have SITA standard and SITA fast. And SITA is abbreviated as a Swedish Interactive Threshold Algorithm. Normally, SITA standard takes more time compared to SITA fast. Here you can see SITA standard took 5 to 10 minutes. So SITA standard took 5 to 10 minutes. But in SITA fast, it took 2 to 5 minutes. So which is more faster than SITA standard. Preparing the patient for testing. Patching an eye. First, we need to patch the eye. So here you can see the strap pushing upperly down, which is improper. So patching should be proper like this. Next, patient chin should be placed on chin rest and forehead on headrest properly. Then we have trial lens location. Lens should be centered properly. It should not be too close and eye should be at the center and it should not be too low. Then aligning the patient, the plus sign should be centered to the pupil. It should not be up, down or sideways. Then parameters for testing. Keep the lights off when you start the HFA. We have fixation target. So here we have central fixation target, which is in yellow color, which is used for most of the people. Then we have diamonds fixation target. There are two types, small and large diamonds. So these are used if there is any loss of central vision, like macular degeneration. So this is the target where patient looks, and this is the response button. So whenever the patient looks the light, he need to press the response button. And it is the visual, how we see in display screen. And the patient should be instructed to view the fixation target and not to look away from it at any point during the test. So after the test, we get single print analysis printout like this. These are known as zones. And totally we have 8 zones. In zone 1, we have patient data and test data. And in zone 2, we have reliability indices. In zone 3, we have grayscale. In zone 4, we have raw data. In zone 5, we have total deviation plot. Zone 6, pattern deviation plot. Zone 7, global indices. And zone 8, that is GHD glaucoma ME field test. In zone 1, we have patient data and test data. So here, we have name of the patient, date of birth, date, time, pupil size, age, visual acuity. And age should be entered properly. Otherwise, it will not match with the normative data which is stored in the instrument. And pupil size should be normal, but not too small. If it is less than 2 mm, then there will be edge scotomas. And in test data, we have test point pattern, whether it is 30-2 or 24-2. Then we have test strategies, like whether it is SITA fast or SITA standard. Then we have size of the stimulus. It should be 3. If there is any poor retinal sensitivity, then we can switch on to stimulus 4 or 5. Then we have reliability indices. In this, we have false positive error, false negative error, fixation loss, and test duration. So coming to the fixation loss, so here patient doesn't fixate at the center. So when the light falls on the blind spot, patient shouldn't respond. But if he responds to the light, there can be movement of his eye. And the normal value is less than 20%. So here you can see 7/18 and 2 crosses. So it indicates the fixation loss is high. If the values are in fraction, you need to convert it into percentage and you need to check it. Then we have false positive errors. So here, even if there is no light, but still the patient may respond with the flow of sound. So he is not focused to the light. Sound would be there in the instrument. A patient might be responded or press the button by hearing the sound. And we call them as trigger happy patients. And if the values are more than 33%, it is unreliable. We need to pause the test if still the patient is clicking the button. And we need to explain that he need to press the button only when he sees the light. Then we have false negative errors. Even if there is bright light, but still patient doesn't press the button. Reasons can be like due to tired, inattentive, or fatigue. And the normal value is around less than 33%. If it is more than 33%, then it is unreliable. Then we have zone 3, that is grayscale. So here we check the density of color, and the density of color only doesn't indicate that there can be any type of abnormal visual field effect. So we can have the gross identification of where can be the visual field loss. And in zone 4, that is raw data, this is assessed. based on subjective response. So we can find how much is the retinal sensitivity in raw data. Then we have zone 5, that is total deviation plot. And here we have two subtypes, that is total deviation numerical plot and total deviation probability plot. In total deviation numerical plot, we see depth and magnitude of visual field loss. And in total deviation probability plot, we get to know how much extent is the visual field loss. Then we have probability symbols. So here we have P less than 5%, less than 2%, less than 1%, and less than 0.5%. So if P is less than 5%, it indicates that this degree of loss sensitivity of that point is seen in less than 5% of normal population. So it provides statistical representation of the population. So here is an example for total deviation plot. So if you see in normative data, it is 27. And in raw data, it is 28. And in deviation plot, it is plus 1. Means plus 1 is the deviated. So if it is in plus sign, it means more retinal sensitivity compared to normative data. And if you see 25 at raw data, and in deviation plot, it is minus 3. Means minus 3 is deviated. And if you see normative data, it is 28. That means the retinal sensitivity is less compared to normative data. So in total deviation numerical plot, mainly we see how much is deviated from normative data. Then we have zone 6, that is pattern deviation plot. Here there are two subtypes, pattern deviation numerical plot and pattern deviation probability plot. For example, if there is any opacities like cataract or high refractive errors, due to opacities, the retinal sensitivity will be less. It doesn't mean that particularly the patient is having less retinal sensitivity. So in pattern deviation plot, it filters and gives the original data. So here you can see in total deviation, there are more black squares. So there are more black squares due to less retinal sensitivity. But in pattern deviation compared to total deviation, there are reduced. So here it has filtered and gives the original data. So the main aim is to filter out the retinal sensitivity. Then we have zone 7, that is global indices. We have mean deviation, that is MD, which gives overall value of the total amount of visual field loss. And the normal range is plus or minus 4 decibels. So if it is minus value, indicates field loss. If it is plus value, it indicates field is above average. Then we have PSD, that is pattern standard deviation, and the normal range is plus or minus 2 decibels. It is derived from pattern deviation. It highlights focal loss only. So if it is in plus sign, indicates local scotoma. If it is in minus sign, indicates generalized scotoma. Then we have VFI, visual field index, or staging index. It indicates how much severity and vision potential in eye. So it will be in percentage. If it is more than 80%, visual field is better. If it is less than 20%, visual field is less. Then if it is in 50%, it is average. Then we have short-term fluctuation. It indicates intra-test variability. Here, the light will blink twice. Values are rechecked, and we see the mass difference between 1 and 2. The short-term fluctuation more than 3 decibels indicates unreliable result. Normal value is plus or minus 2 decibels. Then we have CPSD, that is corrected pattern standard deviation. So here PSD is corrected for short-term fluctuation. Short-term fluctuation due to pathology, PSD will be better. Short-term fluctuation due to unreliability, PSD will be worse. Then we have zone 8, that is glaucoma ME field test. This is only available in 24-2 and 30-2. It evaluates 5 zones in the superior. Mirror images of each set, superior to inferior. We find out how much is the difference between the two. And we have diagnostic outcomes like GST within normal limits, GST outside normal limits, borderline, general reduction in retinal sensitivity, abnormally high retinal sensitivity. Then we have Anderson criteria. So here there are 3 criteria. There are pattern deviation plot, CPSD, and GHD. So in pattern deviation plot, here we need to exclude the edge borders. So at 3 points with p-value less than 5%, 1 point with p-value less than 1%, and in CPSD, with p-value less than 5% and in GHT, in glaucoma ME filters, that is outside normal limits. So these are known as Anderson criteria. Then we have fixation control, that is gaze tracking. So here there are spikes. So if the spikes are upwards, it indicates gaze error. So if the spikes are downwards, it indicates that patient is blinking. So if it is in straight line, then it is a good fixation. So at the bottom, you can see the bad gaze tracking graph. So here you can see there are so many gaze errors. So the test reliability will be poor. In this case, we need to repeat the test. And these are my references. Thank you.
That was really a nice presentation, Shravani. I think we don't have any queries now. So I would like you to share your experience about Foroptum.
Yes. I thank Foroptum team for giving me the opportunity to participate in this webinar. And I thank all my NSO teachers for their support. And I thank Deepa ma'am for advising us to participate in this session. And I thank Rahul sir and Sharad sir for the support and the guidance. And I thank all the viewers who spent their time for listening my presentation. Thank you, Ananda.
Thank you, Shravani, for sharing your knowledge with us. I would like to thank all the audience for being supportive.